Thank you very much for the opportunity, worthy Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellor, our distinguished guests, literati, icons from the intellectual world, my teachers, my mentors. I'm so indebted to each one of them. And I'm so thankful to each one of you for having spared time and for making this event special and memorable for each one of us. Thank you very much. Whenever a book of poetry comes out, it is as though a voice is born. A voice has been lent to the voiceless. It is as though the intangible and the impalpable has been brought alive within the folds of poetry. This is what we call the alchemy of art. My students who are sitting here, the students of literature, can very well relate to the alchemy of art. There's also a book by the name of The Alchemist. See, in the medieval period, it was believed that you could convert any base metal into gold. It was believed, rather misconceived. This was a misconstrued notion. But an artist literally does that. An artist actually converts the base metal into gold, literally by sifting material from the ordinary, the mundane, the humdrum, and turning them into pieces of art which are aesthetically pleasing and intellectually stimulating. And hence, poetry turns out to be the alchemical and the subliminal enterprise. So this book that you have, Inscapes, which refers to the internal landscapes, is something that I would like to relate to. W.B. Yeats is a poet of British-Irish descent. He says, out of a quarrel with others, we produce rhetoric. And out of a quarrel with ourselves, we produce poetry. So these are some very internal, heartfelt musings in the name of Inscapes. Let me introduce you. I'm not going to talk about the book myself. We have a very distinguished panel who are going to shed light on that, inshallah. But just to cast a very cursory glance over the book itself. The book defies chronology. Although a lot of poems were actually formed and they came to me naturally during my government college university days. It's my alma mater. Even the titles are at times evocative. One of the titles of the poems is The Rising Riptide in the Ravi. And hence, we can make connections with the Ravian spirit, which was always at work, always lurking behind my creative pursuits. There's another title, The Rites of Passage. Although the thematic concerns of this poem and other poems are divergent, but the locus of this poem is my alma mater. And I would like to take this opportunity to urge my students to fall in love with their alma mater, with DSU. This happens to be a seat of learning. You have your teachers, the atmosphere, the ambience is so conducive to learning as well as creativity. I often ask my students to fall in love with rewords, all the rewords, that is to rework, to redo, to research, because all of these words hold a lot of promise within their folds. That is, you can always start anew, you can always go back, revisit a text. Just as you can revisit a text, you can always go back in time and improvise and innovate, precisely the function of literature. To encourage, to induce creation and recreation of values. I would like to quote from Shakespeare something that he says in his play, A Midsummer Night's Dream. This is the fifth act, Act 5. Says, the lunatic, the lover, and the poet are of imagination all compact. So he treats the lunatic, the lover, the poet in the same row. All defy spatial, temporal boundaries. Literature offers us that liberal and liminal space which is beyond fixities and finalities. So I would also like to encourage my students to create and recreate something in the strain of Nietzsche. Friedrich Nietzsche had to say, man has the indomitable will to create and recreate values. I would not like to take much time, but just one function of literature. Most of you might be thinking that why literature, why poetry? We've got some important things to indulge in. See, this is my thesis. You see, there is so unrest that prevails in the society precisely because we have ceased to indulge in creative pursuits. They say in English, all art is the sublimated form of frustration. You render your frustration sublime, you arrive at art and craft, something that helps channel that excess energy, that excess emotion. So at one level, yes, the function of poetry is to lend pleasure. Yes, it is an exercise in catharsis, but at the same time, it also advocates the universal precepts of human goodness, human excellence. Art cannot do without it. It is not possible. Something like the existentialist proclaim. The existentialists have to say something to the effect of man is condemned to choose, man is condemned to be free. Likewise, for art, we can say art is compelled, almost condemned to advocate a set of values. Whether you like it or not, there is an innate and an inherent structure of values that is always at work. So a few critics have deemed this work of art as protest poetry. Somebody consider it as an unequivocal voice in feminism. I don't deny any of these, because once art is formed, we consign it into the care of the readers. It is as though an animate being is born and the umbilical cord needs to be severed for this living being to live on its own. Likewise, a work of art is consigned to readership so that it can live on, it can lead its own independent existence. So I would like, once again, I would like to thank all of you. I would also urge my students to start indulging in imaginative pursuits. They say in English, imagination happens to be the sixth sense. For us to decipher reality, realities which extend on the physical plane of existence, we need to have our five sensory framework intact. Either you look at a certain thing, you can touch it, you can hear it, you can smell it, or taste it. These are a few parameters of judging something on the physical plane of existence. But there are so many facets of reality which extend beyond the physical, beyond the terrestrial. And in literature, we call this sixth sense beyond the five senses as imagination. Imagination that is replete with possibilities. Imagination that opens a host of possibilities and is in close proximity with literature, with the art and craft of writing. So inshallah, it is hoped that this humble body of literature might enrich human experience in whichever way possible, inshallah. Would just recite, not the whole poems at all, just a few couplets. See, artists are very sensitive beings. Stimuli in the external atmosphere might not move ordinary people at all, but might move an artist, a writer, a poet, a lover with a much, much greater momentum and thrust. So the poem says, it's a hot pot. I'm just reading the first and the last stanza. Poised on the two-wheeler, the wife sports the hot pot. Behind her husband's back, on the two-wheeler, her dupatta aloft, cleavages through dark lanes atop, stumbling over every tantrum. It is hard to keep the fulcrum, but for a superwoman who has juggled her starved belly to fill the coffers of their aviary. Yes. Sorry, can you scroll back a little? Here it is. The hand of time has rendered her supple neck a rubber stamp. As he leaves the table, the maker of the kitchen sink tragedy, the near past looms large inside the rear view mirror of the uneasy two-wheeler. She has mastered the art of disinterest. She only cares to hold fast the promise of a better life. It's a hot pot. It's a treasure for a haggard wife. So at times the characters are prototypes, engaging us at a Jungian level, allowing us the freedom to partake of the collective human unconscious experience. This poem is interesting in that the title says drama. At times, poetry becomes drama. It's very interesting how different genres of literature mingle into other genres, how they fuse into each other. So sometimes poetry can also read like drama. The theatrics of reason, mind with verve, thespian ego flashes lights upon the anti-hero, directs the act and swerves. The stage set in limbo may clothe the meaning in sartorial eccentricity. The spotlight shines on the select actor, the prerogative of the director's conditioning. To him are we the characters, groveling in self-reflexive, to clap as he enacts the meaning, oral renditions of vows to creativity and the lot of actors defying it. The script is not a divine screed. Let the director and his team reread it. So when you read a text, it is more of rereading the subtext. Coming to the, that actually interests me now that I read this piece of poetry or any poem that I've written. It is not from the vantage point of the poet. It is from the vantage point of the reader. As a reader, I'm reading this out to you. See, the director sweating, the auditors on the aisles of metafiction, toing and froing the liberal lanes of literature. Thank God, the Schengen visa confers clearance upon the free movement of ideas. Travel the rugged slope down from English literature, dives headlong to submerge the ocean into the ocean of literatures in English. I see myself as the most exquisite silence voicing English. You can find post-colonial currents also interfering with my thought process. Not going to read this on request of anonymity. A lot of poems deal or are a commentary on our socio-political predicament. The mouthpieces of bureaucracy can gloat in the bout of anonymity. The only prerogative, the nameless channel sport, globe-trotting with a state of emptiness, but in the times of adversity, done loathsome apathy. If namelessness pervades, the bubble of honesty balloons and bursts in at scenes of uncertainty. If tagged, their long tongues are gagged, and the bubble ruptures in entirety. The double speak churns out laws of diplomacy, and you cannot say conspiracy apart from diplomacy. Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity.